welcome to Business Television India. I'm Abhishek Ranjan and you're watching The Financial Planner. Today on the show, we put the spotlight on debt instruments and the value they add to one's portfolio. To discuss the same, I'm joined by Feroze Azeez, Deputy CEO of Anand, Rathi Private Wealth Management. Welcome to the show, Feroze, and thank you so much for joining us. Upfront, if I may ask you, why have you always maintained that debt instruments are an integral part of one's investment portfolio?
Great. So when you look at different asset classes in the country you reside in or the money which you have in Indian rupees, as an investor, it's important to understand that you have equity, real estate, which are the growth assets, debt and gold as the conservative or the protection assets. Debt in India is a very, very important part of the portfolio because one is that you are in a high interest rate economy. High interest rate, by which I mean you can almost earn 8% on debt. Of course, 8% doesn't look so big unless you do a relative comparison with emerged countries which have 1-2% as the debt interest rate, point one. Point two is that because the inflation is high, your value of your portfolios will keep deteriorating in the form of purchasing power. The power to purchase with your money will keep deteriorating. So debt helps you restore that power to a certain extent. Third is that because debt becomes a very important part, it automatically creates a hedge to equity. For example, if you have 50 rupees invested in equity, 50 in debt, your 100 rupees is almost protected over a 3-year basis automatically. Why do I say so? Let's assume equity which you have put 50 rupees in out of your 100 rupees deteriorates in value and becomes 40 rupees. The other 50 rupees which you have put in debt, because that has a certainty, near certainty of making 8% a year, in 3 years it becomes almost 62 rupees or 60 rupees or more. So what happens is there is a natural hedge because equity can depreciate in value, debt will appreciate in value. So as an overall portfolio, your 100 rupees remain protected on a 3-year basis. So debt helps you get into the courage of investing in equity. So that's these are the 3-4 reasons why you cannot ignore debt in a high inflationary, high interest economy.
Also, if you could provide your rationale of choosing debt funds out of the entire universe that is available to one's discretion?
See, firstly, there are several categories. If I'm not wrong, there are 16 different debt fund categories. Unfortunately, I think in the aspiration of simplifying the mutual fund industry, we still have a certain degree of complexity. Debt funds of 16 category are not needed for an individual investor. Most of them could have relevance from a corporate debt perspective, and the difference in performance in all of them and the risk and return payoffs are very low. So firstly, important or the more popular debt fund categories is what let's look at, and then probably I'll go on to how to choose between those categories. First choose categories and then choose products inside those categories. People look at FMPs. They look at corporate debt funds. They look at AAA rated bank PSU funds. And then the fourth category is credit risk fund. So these are the 4 categories which are relevant from a perspective of an individual investor to manage his own private wealth, if not the company wealth. So these are the 4 categories in which if I have to arrange them in the chronological order of my preference, I would say credit risk funds would be right up there. And then comes corporate debt fund, bank and PSU funds, and then FMPs. This is the chronological order of importance I would give to these 4 categories. The rest of the 10-12 categories are ignorable, like a liquid fund or an ultra short bond fund. All those are other categories which you should ignore and simplify life and look at these 4 categories only. Now, Abhishek, to answer your question, how to choose from them? If you're buying credit risk funds, be rest assured that the most important thing is diversification, because you have to bring down the credit risk by diversifying it. If it's a credit risk fund, diversification is important. So when a client, or for my own portfolio, when I buy credit risk funds, I ensure that with those funds, I get at least 200 companies whom I'm lending my money to. So that automatically spreads my money thin enough that if a couple of companies go bankrupt also, my money is safe because the other 198 are safe and they're paying me interest. So that's the strategy on the credit risk side. Of course, you can have bank and PSU funds as your part of your portfolio because they bring in some degree of stability because of the banking exposure they have. And Indian banks are very strongly regulated. And FMPs, to my mind, at least with the latest episodes of their extensions and defaults, FMPs are a no-no because they are closed-ended in nature. And if there is any default, you can't even react. You can't sell them on the exchange. They are listed, but there's hardly any liquidity. So FMPs, because of their closed-ended nature, is why they are right at the bottom in terms of a preference or a choice.
And Feroz, what are the aspects that you evaluate in a credit fund when you recommend a credit fund?
See, one is in a fund, there are two, three sources of making money. The most important source in a credit risk fund is the interest payment, which is called the YTM of the fund. Every fund's fact sheet shows something called YTM, yield to maturity. Every investor should look at yield to maturity, subtract the expense of the fund, which means that the interest, let's assume the interest, the bonds which are there in the fund are accruing is 10%. If the expense is 2%, the net yield which the client will receive in the form of interest accruals through the fund is 8%, 10 minus 2. So the first criteria is yield my YTM minus expense. Second criteria is its diversification. Buy funds which have several bonds rather than 10, 12, 15 bonds. So most credit risk funds can have 30 to 40 bonds. So that's the second criteria, diversification. Third is the past track record of how many times has the fund generated the yield which it promised at the beginning of the period in the form of the disclosure. So these are the three most important criteria which a fund should be chosen upon. And I think you can also look at financial planner and get the outputs of what the three criteria is.
Feroz, you've been suggesting to invest in debt mutual funds. Now talking of broader risk categories, that is interest rate risk and credit risk, which of the two is worth taking the risk?
See, so when it looks at risk, Abhishek, if I understood your question right, I think swapping between risks, interest rate risk, which is also there in certain bond funds, which are dynamic bond funds and income funds, I think is the least efficient risk for a person to take in his or her portfolio. Because interest rates come down, bond prices go up, this phenomena of making money in a falling interest rate situation is called interest rate risk. So in my opinion, for the several risks we take in the equity side and the debt side, the most inefficient risk for which you don't get a commensurate return enough is called the interest rate risk, because it is not a compounding variable, it is a non-compounding variable. So that's what I would say, Abhishek, in terms of my least preferred risk. But of course, credit risk is a very good risk to take if you have a very good fund manager. Like Franklin, for example, have pioneered in credit risk fund management, and they've generated almost 20% more over the last 5-year periods against a AAA rated fund for most of my clients, 20% in the last 7 years. I would like to correct myself. So that 20% extra is the value Franklin Templeton brought over and above a AAA rated counterpart. So credit risk is a very good risk to take. Interest rate risk is a no-no to my mind. And most people end up taking interest rate risk, which does not reward them like the credit risk, which I just illustrated.
That's it for this edition of Financial Planner. Stay tuned to Business Television India for more news and updates on the other side. Thanks for watching.